What benefits can online education bring to us as in terms of achieving our mission, achieving our educational goals, outcomes from classrooms? What can online do that face-to-face cannot do?
I defer to Eric on that one.
I'm a big proponent of online. I think there's a lot of things that it does really well. I think there's certainly losses, right? There's things that we lose along the way. But I think it's particular in thinking about seminary education. It is an odd decision, I think, to deroute people from the places where they're already living, bring them to this new place, this kind of artificial bubble where they live, where they study for 3 or 4 years, and then we send them right back. There are benefits, right? You create community, you create this kind of learning community where people are living and studying all the same things. But I think there's a benefit in people learning where they are, in the communities where they're already serving, in the communities where they already know all the people. And then what you do is you bring the classroom to them. Mm-hmm. Ideally, I think that's what online education can do. The danger, of course, is that we just commodify education, that we're able to prepackage this stuff and give it to anybody, anywhere. The challenge is for the professor to contextualize these pieces in all these different environments. Mm-hmm. In all these different, I've got, in my Greek class, I had students from Norway, from Turkey, from exotic places like Texas and North Dakota. But for all of them, right, what does it mean to be learning this ancient language in all these different contexts? Or what does it mean to be reading the Bible in all these different contexts? So it requires a ton of work from us on our end. I find teaching online actually requires more work than walking into
especially when you start.
We have to set everything up. So it is a lot of work, but I think the deliverable, the positive of it is that you're meeting people where they are.
So I had one student, he came for a tour on campus. He's Hawaiian, third generation Japanese American. And he's come to Portland, Oregon from Hawaii. And he's excited, but we're talking like, look, it's gonna be hard. It's gonna be hard on your family. And he became my poster child for online learning. He stayed in Hawaii, where all his family is, where all his in-laws, his parents, his children stayed in the school. He had a good job that he was able to keep. He was able to not leave his community of faith, which is hugely lacking in leadership in this particular time, but come and join a community online and join us face-to-face one time every semester. Yeah. And you talk to him, it blows his expectations. He was able to learn and apply and not uproot his family and get this education in a place where there isn't, in Hawaii, where there isn't a lot of, there isn't as much choice of theological education as you would get in LA or Boston.
We should start a seminary in Hawaii.
Okay, so I actually proposed the extension campus cohort with a week intensive.
And can I teach?
It was hugely popular. We're there. For some reason, it was hugely popular with the faculty. I don't know.
I think all the Minnesotan Lutherans are going to be hopping on.
They're really welcome to come.
They'll be happy to come along.
You're welcome to come. How with undergrads and online teaching?
I mean, I would be up for trying it, but we just don't have the resources, I think. So the college did try last summer, like two little pilot courses, but the expense is such that they wanted it to be popular courses, and religious studies is not really super popular.
You have to add like zombies or something like that, or vampires in the title or something
Like
that.
Or how to get a job with religion. That might work.
That might be a short class.
They could sell it to their parents then.
So what about some of the difficulties? What are the challenges that you found in your online? Yeah.
You know, it's hard. Sometimes there's something about having students sitting in front of you and you see how their posture is, or are they leaning forward, or have their head on the desk, right? And, you know, behind a keyboard, sometimes you can't catch those physical cues. Mm. Students can hide in some ways online that they can't hide in the classroom. Although I find students are really good at hiding anyway, right? They usually sit in the backs. So I think that's one of the challenges, just keeping track of students' engagement with the class. It's harder to know if things are going well or poorly. So that kind of ongoing assessment along the way and asking. So I do a lot of CIQs, which is a Stephen Brookfield thing, asking students, when did you feel most engaged? When did you feel least engaged? Because I think we can often do that with our eyes in a traditional classroom. And online, you have to actually have a mechanism to hear their voices.
You know, a lot of my colleagues complain, and I actually agree. Like, I just like the face-to-face encounter. I just like being present with them. And sometimes we do it hybrid, but online, it's just more challenging. But in a positive way, when you write, you think differently than when you just speak off the cuff. And I think that's a value.
And for some students, it's much easier for them to write than to speak aloud.
Absolutely, yes.
So I think it also enables kind of those writing processes where people need to sit and think a little bit more. I think it levels the playing field a bit for
them. It levels, but some people don't like that level playing field. I know some people want to just listen to professor or just talk and that's wax poetically, and so that's a challenge to sell it to them.
Thank you for joining us from Stories from the Front of the Classroom.